Some of us, interested in the five kanta or the five aggregates. I would like to talk a little bit about this. This five kanta or five aggregates is the very old concept before the Buddha. People in ancient India, classify or categorize our life in five groups. The first group is body or material, physical thing. And the second is nama or mind. The mind have many functions, so they categorize the mind as four functions. The first one is consciousness, vijnana. Consciousness is the knowing when the sense object and sense organ meet together. If your sense organ is effective and you have mind to know it, this is what we call consciousness that can happen or can arise at your eyes, ear, nose, tongue, body, and mind. The second, when you have the consciousness, sometimes there arise vedana or feeling. It's hard or easy to bear it. For example, when you hear the music, the beautiful music, the feeling is good because it's harmony. But when you hear some very loud noise, such as the bomb, bum, this is very difficult to bear it and give you unpleasant feeling. This vedana is also, it can arise every time you have the consciousness. And you can also put the meaning of that thing. This we call sanya. Sanya is not just the memory, but it depends on how we want to memorize it. This is the sanya. Sometimes we memorize it correctly, sometimes we memorize it in the not correct way. And this sanya is the information for your thinking. The thinking or your mental formation is the sankhara. Your sankhara can form in the correct way, in the correct way, or in the wrong way. If you form any concept, any idea in the wrong way, you create the I, it's mine, it's me. If you think in this way, you may have some suffering or conflict. But if you see things clearly, it's impermanence, it belongs to nature, it is not yours. If you consider in this way, you will not form this concept, ego, I, me, and mine. And this is the way that our mind reacts. And this mental formation is really important, because when you think, it makes you speak or have action, bodily action. Okay, so, and this is the five aggregates that the Buddha said that in the five aggregates itself is nature, natural, no problem. But the problem arises when we do not have mindfulness, when we have contact or consciousness. When vedana or feelings arise, if it's present feeling, we want to cling, to stay with it. But it not last long, it will pass away. We do not want it to pass away. We do not separate or depart from it. So now we create the conflict. Or sometimes unpleasant feeling arise, and it will pass away, but this unpleasant feeling make us think or have the sankhara again, try to push it out, try to destroy it, try to run away from it. And after this concept arise, develop the belief that I or me or mine will stronger and stronger. But if you just have mindfulness, you see what happens when that contact, sense organ and sense object from outside contact, have consciousness. And this consciousness pass away, has feeling, this feeling also pass away. If you see this clearly, the way you memorize things or the way you think will be correct, it will be pure. But if you do not have this mindfulness, you will attach to that thing. The khanda or the five aggregates will not be the void or the nature aggregate, natural aggregate, but it become upanakhan, or the aggregate with attachment. And this attachment makes you suffer, not the khanda. If you have the mindfulness with every time you have contact, such as the arahant or the one who have perfectly mindfulness and wisdom, we call his khanda is a pure khanda. Now he's not purified because this mindfulness help him to not to attach to that thing. So we have three kind of khanda. The first one is original khanda, it's natural khanda that arise in the human being. And then if we attach, it become attachment khanda, upanana khanda. And if we do not attach, if we have mindfulness, it become pure khanda. This is the thing. Any more questions? So that if there's no more questions, I will explain this rather long. You can take the... We have three kind of course slave. The first one is the easy course slave. It's a Burmese style. You just put your feet, your leg together, but don't need to cross it. Just you cross it, but don't need to put it on another. If you put the right one or the left one, because it's a half lotus. And if you cross it double, it's the full lotus. This is good because it's balanced, but it's not necessary. You can sit on the chair as you if you have some problem about your health, but very important to keep your back stretch your back. Do not lean the wall or the anything.
But then, sitting across and half of it, but you don't feel much pain or no feeling.
That is why in the full of the pain feeling, right?
No, I just...
If you want to sit in flow and you take time to develop, to get used to that thing, it's good. And in future, you will not have any pain if you sit in this flow every day. But at the beginning, you sit just for 3 minutes, 5 minutes, and then later you can develop it more and more. Uh-huh.
I don't understand
the question.
If you sit for 1 hour...
In fact, about sitting, we don't need to sit so long. If you want to practice mindfulness, not concentration, you can practice mindfulness in any posture, in any activity. If you sit and you feel you can continue sitting for an hour or more than that, that's okay. But don't need to. Not necessarily to try to control the time. You just practice to have calm mind, and you know what happened in your mind, in your body, uh-huh. And check that your breathing is correct or not. Mm-hmm. Take the deep long breath and fine breath. This helps you. I not get the point that you do not feel at this. I think because please check your breathing, the way you breathe. Uh-huh. You may sit. In fact, you don't need to sit so long. You can sit, or you can walk, or you can practice in different posture. But the most important thing is to breathe correctly. You relax your body, relax your mind, and your mindfulness is fast to know everything and let it go. This is more important. If you just get the concentration, you may sit for 4 hours a day, so you can do nothing, right? And also when you return to your daily life, it's very, very big difference, very, very, very much different between your meditation and your daily life. So you have conflict also. And sometimes you cannot control your mind much when you associate with the people. But if you practice mindfulness, when you calm, you also good. When you associate with the people, you also be mindful and react it properly. In China, you know, there's a story that a monk go to India for many years and practice meditation, and then he returned to his monastery. And the abbot asked him that, "What you learn from India?" He said, "I learned meditation." So he sit for 2 and 3 hours, close his eye and sit still, like the Buddha image. And after that, he opened his eye after 2 hours passed. And he practices many days. Then the abbot come and ask him, "In our monastery, we have enough Buddha image. We have enough the Buddha image already. No. So we don't want any new one. we should try to develop the mind and then put it in our work, our daily life." If you just learn to sit and close your eye only, that is not perfect. If you breathe short, your body will not good. If you breathe short, so please check you breathe long or not. Some people have the habit of breathing short, very short, so they come and practice meditation at the beginning, he don't know what is the long breath, because he breathe very short, especially the person who live in the city and always hurry. If you always hurry up, your breath will be short, and you will be very, very easy to up and down, because if you can control your breath, your emotion do not change so much, do not change, can control the emotion and control the body also. So try to stay with the breath, the long breath, this is better. Now we will talk about how to live as a lay people, if you want to ordain or if you don't want to ordain, according to your as you like. The Buddha suggests you can choose both lay people lifestyle or ordination. But these two groups they practice the same. They practice to end suffering. This is the goal of our life. But the lay people have more work, more job, more worry. So they walk really slowly, but they must go to the same goal. They walk really slowly because they carry many things with them. But the one who want to ordain, do not have any burden in their life, so they can walk faster because they do not take or carry anything with them. If you have your house, your husband, your wife, your children, this make you concerned more. So you walk slower. But you need to know how to walk correctly, or you must have the correct goals, correct aim. Because if you don't know how to walk, the burden will, the heavy load of the burden will make you more and more suffer. Yeah. And if you walk on the wrong way, you will go more far and far away from your goal of life. This is the way that what the Buddha taught to deal with the burden. The burden in our life is in Thai, in Bali we have the word. The property is our born at our feet. Putto ki ve thanang pa te pariya hatte. The money or the property is the born of our feet. The wife is the born of our hand. And the son is born of our neck. Because we worry about the property, we cannot go anywhere, right? If you worry about your wife or husband, you are more busy. And your son, your children, you concern them more. So these three things is a thing that we should aware. But the one who want to ordain will be free from all these things, and they can move more. Faster. As a layman, the Buddha suggests them to live for three. Our goal of life, our purpose, have three levels. The first one is to success in this daily life, in this world. That means if you want some property, if you want some fame, if you want some power, if you want some friends, some community with you, that's okay. But try to have all of these things in the right way. That means do not break the precept. You keep the precept, right? And then you have effort, energy. You can gain all of this with your effort, if your action. But only fame, poverty, power, and friends cannot help you so much. We can get many material things, but it satisfies you only at the physical level. But the better one is to know how to use all of these things properly. If you know how to use the money or property, to spend your money, which we call the pokatap or the worldly property, and create the better one, create the inner property. Inner property is the thing that make you are rich. You feel you are rich already. Someone have money but they do not feel rich because they have craving. They want more and more. They do not satisfy with what they have, what they get. But if you have contentment, my name means contentment or satisfaction, you may have more money, less or much money, no problem. And you can spend your money for the benefit of other people, because you know that this money you create happiness for other people. And when you see some people happy, this also make you happy. So this man know how to use their property to gain the better things. We call this level, this aim, as the paratha, or the benefit for other. This other means for other people, for other world, and for other level of happiness. If you keep property for your own, only yourself can happy. But this happiness do not last long. But if you give to the people, give to the public, this property will last long, because it makes people happy. And then it also makes you happy in the higher level. Anytime you remind yourself about good deeds that you do, it makes you happy. So by this way, you know how to spend your property. The Buddha suggests the four virtues for the the second level, to have confidence, to have sila, to have charity, and to have wisdom. If you have these four virtues, you develop your life more than just to get material things. And the highest goal of our life as a lay people is to flee, to be free from all attachment. You may have money. If you want some money but you do not have any dhamma practice, you may steal or you may do some corruption because you want some money. This is not good at all. But if you collect your money from your work, from your action, if you perform this correctly, you get some money, but sometimes you do not know how to use. If you know how to use, it will be you help you to have more happiness and for other people. But the highest thing is that not to attach to the money. If you attach to the money, you cannot spend the money for your benefit or for other people. You just keep it, and you want it more and more in the bank. You want to see the amount of the money, but do not use it. By this way, you become slave of the money. You do not use money, but the money use you. You must work for the money, right? So the money is useless, but you must do a lot of work or worry so much about this thing. So the Buddha praised the one who free from attachment to money. If you still have money, you know how to use it. But if you want to ordain, you can give up all property. Give this to the person who wants it, and to live without any worry about property. That's better. So you should know what is the happiness from being free from attachment. If you have experience of these things, then you are ready to ordain or ready to lead the noble life. If you do not know this, you may think that to ordain is good because you don't need to worry about people, you don't need to worry about work or property. In fact, you face another trouble if your mind does not understand all of these things. Because if you want some money, some property, but when you ordain, you cannot have it, you cannot get it, but you still want it. So this will make you more suffer. You need to get a better happiness. So when you ordain, you need to practice sila and meditation more and gain happiness from meditation. The calm happiness is better than fun happiness. The real happiness is better than sensual pleasure. So if you have this kind of happiness, it will help you to be content with your poor and peaceful life. If you don't have this kind of happiness, it's very suffer. It very much suffer to ordain, because you do not get any happiness. You cannot get happiness from material things, and also you cannot get happiness from your meditation. So you need to try to reduce the material things or happiness from material, but develop more the happiness of meditation. If you gain concentration or wisdom more and more, the sensual pleasure will be less and less influence on your mind. And now you are ready to ordain. And if you train this way, when you ordain, you can help other people. Many people just ordain to practice, or someone do not ordain to practice at all. They ordain because they think that life of the monk is very, very easy. You don't need to work. You just stay alone, you just stay freely in the monastery. But once you ordain, you will know monks have many things to do to train themselves. And also, they must have some job in the monastery also to help the people. If you do not prepare in this way, you may despite it, your ordination. Sutta already. You know, the Buddha suggests the level of progress in our life, 38 good fortune. It starts with to have, to associate with the wise person, with the bandita, or the one who knows what is wrong, what is right, what is correct. So this one will help you to practice Dhamma, not associate with the bad friend or the foolish friend, because this foolish one will lead you to do something. Sometimes you not know it's good or bad, and then you get the bad result from that thing. To know who is the one who you should respect and try to follow them. This is the beginnings of your noble life. And after that, you need to perform your duty towards your family, to take care of your mother. Before you take care of your mother, father, your parents, you need to learn. You need to train your knowledge, your art, your science, your how to earn your living. You also need to practice all of this. And when you gain money, you must know how to spend it, how to take care your parents. To let your children take care of your wife, take care of your relative. This is the first level of our practice. And contentment with your property, and know how to spend, how to help the people. But the highest one that the Buddha suggests that to train your mind, to free from all attachment, from all property and all relative. Sometimes you have a very good family, but you do not train your mind, so you cannot accept the. Sometimes when they pass away, or sometimes when they have conflict, you still suffer spiritually. Sometimes you success a lot in your business, but you do your business with worry. When you get more money, you also worry. When you lost, you also worry. You also suffer. The Buddha suggests that to practice to drop our mind to be free from all of these things. So he said that to realize Nibbana, realize enlightenment, to purify your mind, do not have stain in your mind. Have any disease in your mind, and have your mind stable, have your mind pure and free. This is the highest thing that we can do. If you succeed doing this as a lay people, it's good, because you can be the example. You can be example of the lay people who succeed. At the Buddha time, many millionaire, many rich people also as a good Buddhist, but they know how to deal with the property, how to share their property with the public, or help the monk, and they are free from attachment. This is the thing that we should know, three levels of our life, to get and to share, and to be free from all that thing. 38 good fortune in the Mangala Sutra. Everything is depend on our action, you know. The good fortune is not from God, or from your past from your past life, your previous life. It can happen today. When you do good thing, good action, it brings good fortune. every time you do it. When you think or when you speak or when you do in a bad way, it become your bad fortune because you create the bad cause, so the bad result will follow in this way. Once of the 38 good fortune said that to do good in the past and to go in the right direction, this is also the same. If you do good in the past, it will be the condition that support your life now. How can you stay here? Because you have good friends in the past. You have good family. Your parents or your teacher or your friends help you. And this is the cause that take you here or bring you to this point. And if you set your direction correctly, you will go forward, progress, more progressive. And if you do good thing now, this good action in future, it will become your good fortune as the thing that you have done in the past. It become the past. Our action now will become our past action.
I think
because the Buddha said that when the Arahanta pass away, there's nothing left. There's nothing left, so he cannot return. But his goodness, the state of mind of the Arahanta is nothing. It's purity, right? So sometimes we say that this purity still remain, but his body is. Then he has nothing to return. It's a state of mind. It's a nature. It's only nature. Very fast. So sometimes some people do not know this. They write some story that the Arahanta come and talk to them. In fact, sometimes they may think he himself think that the Arahanta come. It is his understanding, but not the Arahant cannot come after he passed away.
Excuse me, but his nama rupa will dissolve, isn't it?
Yeah.
The nama also will dissolve.
Yeah.
Because the ordinary worldly, the nama doesn't dissolve.
One thing that I would like to explain more about rebirth. In Sri Lanka tradition, that you listen. The rebirth means to rebirth with the body, right? Your mind performs some things and you attach to that thing. And then this bring you rebirth in the mother womb, in the bodily rebirth. If you understand in this way, so the way to free from rebirth is to purify your mind, right? You don't attach to anything, and then nothing will remain because you have no karma energy to push you to reborn again. This is okay for your practice because you must subject that if you do not purify your mind, you still have good or bad karma. The bad karma will have some energy, some power to make you reborn in the bad realm or bad sphere. But the good energy of karma will cause you happiness. But both of these will still impermanent, still unsecure. So why don't you try for Nibbana or the best one instead of heaven? We should try to the best one, Nibbana. But that's paradox, you know. When you want to achieve Nibbana, you must give up all attachment, right? So we like to achieve heaven more because in heaven we still have this ego, but it's a better ego or is a happy ego, so we want to keep it. And people will like just this level of teaching. But the Buddha suggests that this is not enough. It's not secure. It is not good. So he suggests the Nibbana, or how to go to Nibbana, or how to achieve Nibbana. Nibbana is not the kingdom or the place or the land that we will go. In fact, Nibbana is here and now already. Only we purify our mind, purify our heart from all attachment, we can experience Nibbana with our mind now. With the mind, not our mind. Our mind is just a saying. But with this mind, when this mind has nothing disturbed, then at that moment, Nibbana appears. Nibbana is known by the mind. This is you can experience a taste of Nibbana now. But we lack of mindfulness or wisdom to keep our mind pure eternally or permanently. So we need to practice meditation so that we can our mind will have mindfulness in time, anytime we have contact. When you have no contact, you know, when you not see, do not hear, do not touch, do not smell, do not taste, do not think, the kilesa or defilement do not arise. But when you have contact, this is the point that defilement or the bad mental information arise. If you have mindfulness, you will control this, or you will get rid of this attachment. You just experience the contact and let it pass away. It is nature. It is not your. It is not me. It is not mine. So nothing happened. It's just nature. So now you become one with nature. You just know nature. That's all. When the Arahanta experience things, that's two kind of Nibbana, you know. The first one is the Nibbana when you have experience with things, you still know this is the pleasant feeling or unpleasant feeling. But you do not create the ego. You just know it. It's pleasant or unpleasant. But you do not attach to it. You do not cling to it. So it passes away. No defilement. But the Arahant, the second one who is the second kind of Nibbana, even the pleasant and unpleasant feeling, they do not have it. It's just a feeling, not pleasant or unpleasant feeling. So nothing, not no karma energy anymore. They do not attach to anything. But in the Sri Lanka tradition, they may explain that there's two kinds of Nibbana. The first one is when you enlighten, but your five khandhas still work, still alive, so you still suffer bodily. But when you pass away, both of the kilesa, both of the mind, both of the body pass away, nothing left in this way. I would like to emphasize more about the ego or the birth spiritually. When you want to not to reborn again, you need to control your rebirth now. If you can control your ego rebirth now, there will be no energy to push you anywhere. So if you want to practice to achieve Nibbana, just aware of your contact, aware of your ego. Yeah, no, that's the only way. You may not need to believe in rebirth also. If you don't know, you are not sure that there is the next life or not, it's not the problem. But if you can experience that, if you have no attachment, you have no ego, you are free now. So this is the best state of mind, so you stay with it. If there is any rebirth, you will not rebirth because you will not be reborn because you have nothing attached in your mind. But something that you should be careful, if we explain about rebirth in the Tibetan way or Sri Lanka tradition, sometimes you think that the one who reborn is the same person, right? Mr. A passed away and Mr. A reborn again in the different place. If you think in this way, it's wrong. This one and that one is not the same one. It's some continuity. It's some cause and effect, but it is not the same one. If you think it's the same person, the same one, you create ego or soul. And this is the wrong understanding in Buddhism. The understanding of eternality, sasatatiti. Sasatiti means you think that you yourself will remain all the time, or someone will remain all the time. This is the eternality concept. This is long understanding. But if you think that there is nothing continuity, when you pass away, everything is finished. This is also wrong understanding. We call this nattika titti or ucheta titti. That means nihilism. You do not see the continuity of things at all. But the middle way of the Buddha means that you see there's cause and effect. You see there's a continuity, change, but it changes according to the condition. If there is some cause, they must have the effect, or the fruit, or the result. So if you do not perform any cause for rebirth, so you will stop your reborn. If you continue to do it, you have it. No matter you want it or not, it will have the result. So some people do not aware about this. So they do many good things. They perform merit making, but they do not try to cut off or get off this ego. So they still cling with the merit and still suffer. But it's better than to do evil. To do good is better than to do evil. But if you do not try to reduce or try to get rid of your ego, you still attached. You must born again. Reborn again and then get the result that you do.
In the teaching of the law of cause and effect,
yeah.
We always thought that cause will always manifest into effect. But in the case of the arahantas, do they, when they have attained arahantship, do they have to wait for their past causes, all the past karma pata that they have done, to manifest into vipaka before they can leave the body? Or it's not.
That's true level also. In the spiritual level, the arahanta have no vipaka because he do not create any new karma, so he do not suffer anymore. Such as Ongkulimala, you know, Ongkulimala is the one who kill hundreds of people, but his mind when he enlightened, when he become arahanta, he will not suffer anymore because he do not create the thinking about. So his mind is free already. The arahanta is a free mind, but this body still get what the people give him. People may give him good or bad thing. It depends on what he have done before. But his mind, arahanta mind, have not got anything. But his body sometimes still sick, some still beat, some still suffer. And you know the one who harm the arahanta. Is this This is the karma of that person. So you, we can see that Ongkulima have no karma, but the people still have karma. And what hurt the Ongkulima's Arahanta is not his karma, but the other people's karma. And that people get angry, so hurt Ongkulima, and they get the result also. It belong to other people's karma and vipaka. But Ongkulima himself have no karma anymore. And the vipaka is not him, it's not his, it belong to other people in this way. You know, there's a woman who also enlightened, we call, her name is Ubonvanna Theri. He was enlightened, but later there's a man who liked her, want her as a, so he, but one day after she go for arm, this man come and left her, left this Venerable Theri. What happened? If ordinary people, they must suffer, right? But this Theri, they have no pleasant or unpleasant feeling. So for her, there's no karma to her or in her mind. What happened is to her body only. But this man commit karma because of his lust, and he gained the result. So the Buddha, after that, the Buddha give the rule for the female monk not to live alone in the monastery. The female monk must live in the monastery that have monk together. Because of this case, he want to protect the female monk, but the man who come to live is not. This is the case that really happened. But what is the difference between the mind of Ubonvanna Theri and ordinary female monk? If the ordinary female monk was left, she must cry or do, or sometimes commit suicide. This crying or commit suicide is her karma, right? Because she still, oh, this I was left. This is my body. This is I am very unhappy. But the Theri is free from all of this ego. So she forgives, she do not suffer anymore. But this is not good for ordinary people. So the Buddha gives the new room for the female monk to avoid it.
But in this particular case, you spoke about the rule that the Buddha laid down for Ubonvanna Theri concerning this.
Yeah.
Denial
of the monk, the nuns need to
stay
with at least one other
person, not live alone. Was this rule formulated for her protection, or for the layman's protection, or for the sangha's protection?
I think both, first of all, for the female monk, for the other female monk, this case may happen again, so he want to avoid this. And if that's no, such a case, it's also, if she stay in the monastery with the monk, it's difficult for the man to harm. So it's also help them not to harm her, not to commit the bad karma. And then it's good for our sangha also.
So is it for the community?
The Buddha will give the rules. Because he see the beneficial for the sangha and for the people.
I think in this particular case, Ubonvanna Theri is already an arahan.
Yeah.
It's beyond being harmed mentally, but maybe the physical harm.
Yeah.
The physical harm only can come
to the Buddha, when he give the rule or vinaya, this vinaya for the next person, not for that person only. The person who commit or get the result or get the who the task already passed, but he will start the next one will not have this anymore. And this is the way that Buddha do.
Sometimes a lot of people seem to discuss this concerning denial. what do you think, Pate? Is it the Vinaya that the Buddha introduced for the Sangha, is it still very valid and ethical today?
Some of them not ethical, but we as a Theravada monk try to keep the most we can. In fact, at the Buddha time, at the beginning, there's no rules at all. The Arahanta can eat in the evening, no problem, because eating in the evening is not the sin or the evil thing. But he gives this rule because of some monk do it, and the lay people blame. So the Buddha don't want the monk to be blamed, so he has the rule to keep the not so good monk and to avoid people blaming the monk. So he keeps the rule. If you study the Vinaya, how this Vinaya arises in any case, that is very, very good to understand Indian society. About the money, for example, the Buddha asked the monk not to keep the money. In fact, the money is not means the coin or the banknote. At that time, he used the word silver, gold. That is a precious thing. The monk should not keep it, because it's the thing that the lay people want and the lay people consider precious. But the monk who do not touch it, but have the contentment with to have it, someone keep it for him, this is also wrong. So the Buddha emphasized more both the action and also the mind. But the essence of this Vinaya means that the monk should have money or gold or silver, any precious things as their own, what you call, their private or their own property. It should belong to the Sangha or belong to the public or belong to the group. Only something that necessary for it belong to the monk.
In this case of silver and gold, the Vinaya rule on silver and gold, was there an occasion where this particular rule was formulated? On what occasion was this formulated? After maybe an incident or something? Was there an incident that caused this rule to be formulated?
I think some monks at that time may have some, they get money and people may blame that, oh, you are a monk, you don't need to, you should not concern the money. I think the people may blame like this, because the monk have not allowed to trade, not allowed to get any wage from the people. So in fact the monk don't need any money, because everything people give them free, the food, the lodging, or anything. But nowadays, this is also very difficult, because, for example, in your country, when the monk, where the monk go, if you have no kapiya or no disciple, sometimes you cannot go somewhere. You must walk. At the Buddha time, most of the monk walk, because there are also the rules for the monk not to take the vehicle that use the animal to avoid make the animal suffer. So they will walk. The Buddha also walk. Thousands of kilometers he walk by this way. Because most of the priests in Hinduism also do not use the vehicle that use with the animal. So the Buddha also want to keep it, so that the people will not blame the monk. Okay, this Vinaya come. And some monks in Thailand, you know, they samatthan or they intend to follow this behavior. So anywhere they go, they will not take bus, they must walk. But if they cannot go to Philippines, because Philippines is the island, right? They will not take any sea, any bus, but they can walk, so they can come to Malaysia. Or they can walk to Malaysia, but they will not take any vehicle. So the chain, the China master, cannot go to America, cannot go to the state, because they must go to airplane, and they must cross the river, they must cross the sea. It's not allowed in the Chinism. But in Buddhism, no problem. The Buddha do not allow, just because the people in India think that the monk should not do this. So the monk should not do, because people may blame. But it is not the evil thing to take the bus or to
Bhante, I think the first 60 Arahant disciples of the Buddha, when the Buddha told them to go forth to preach the Dharma for the good and benefit of all many, they must have been having a lot of difficulty if they carry all these denials together and cross out of India to a foreign land where everything is foreign, cultures, traditions are different. And then it's not so simple for them to...
You know, the 60 Arahant, the first group have no Vinaya at all. Have no Vinaya, because at that time, no monks perform the evil. Only they want to ordain. They are ready to ordain. They want to renounce the world. And when they come and they enlighten, they will not commit any evil at all. So that's no need to have rule for this monk. But the rules come later, after the Buddha spread Buddhism for many years. And after that, there's some man think that to become is good. You don't need to work. People give you food, give you many things. So they become monk to get things. But their behavior is not so good. So the people blame the monk. And the Buddha give the rule. And when he give the rule, he said that now I will give the rule. This rule will protect Buddhism longer life, but few people will enlighten. If you teach freely, people will enlighten more, but the Dhamma will disappear also very fast, because you may teach something wrong. But if you have some Vinaya, if you keep the monk together for a long time, but the monk may understand and attached to some minor rules, you know. Attached to some minor rules, so they do not go anywhere. They just keep the rules only.
In this case, Bhante, the first 60 Arahant disciples that left the country and preached, I mean, the devotees that followed these Arahant disciples also would not be caught Vinaya by these 60 Arahant disciples.
No.
So their followers of this group won't be following Vinaya.
But this 60 Arahanta, when he go to spread Buddhism alone, he goes not in the one monk in the one direction. I think he must think about the Buddha. When someone want to ordain, for example, he may take them to ordain with the monk, the Buddha. But later the Buddha think that, if you just bring them to see the Buddha, to ask for a bhikkhu upasampada, it's really difficult because there's a long distance. So he asked the monk that if this man want to ordain and he will take the Buddha Dhamma Sangha as their refuge, if they take this refuge, they can become the monk, right? But later, this ceremony is too easy. Because the people said, just to take refuge and become a monk. And after that, the Buddha set another rule. To ordain a monk, you need a group of monks to vote, to accept you, because they must qualify you, something like that. So he may ask about 10 monks to qualify, to accept. But later, there's some area, very few monks. They wait many years until they can have 10 monks together. So the Buddha reduced again for that area, just fewer than that, that's okay. But in some area, it's not so difficult. We should need some amount, number of monks. So the Vinaya will develop according to the Some monks enlightened already, but they still practice Vinaya, not just for himself, but for to be a good example for the newcomer. Sasat Mahakasapa. Mahakasapa like to live in the forest, like to death in the very, very old clothes. And this is the just for example for the newcomer to satisfy with the simple life.
Sometimes very often people get confused between these two words, concentration and mindfulness.
Yeah.
The definition doesn't seem to be very clear in people's mind. And also at the same time, the interrelation between concentration and mindfulness when they come to doing meditation.
Uh-huh.
They can't see very clearly the difference between two different
The mindfulness or sati, the quality of sati is fast, it's quicker. The word sati comes from the root parivatsara. Sara means arrow. At that time, the arrow is the thing that fast, the fastest thing, the quickest thing. Nothing faster than the arrow. So the Buddha used the word sati. Represent the quickness of the mind to recognize the contact or anything that comes to your mind, to your sense organ. This is the state, right? And when you are when you contact anything, this state will bring your wisdom. You have some knowledge in the past and apply it, it becomes sambacchanya. This is the sati panya sambacchanya together. Have the ability to know. This is the ability to know fast and clear. But the concentration, the samadhi, is the one mind at one thing. The mind stay with one thing. If your state continuity at one thing, you gain concentration, samadhi or concentration you gain from sati. Similar to when you put the dots, you know, you put it many times, if you make a line, the concentration is a line, the sati is a dot. And this line, if you put more dots, it will be a very, very hard, very, very heavy. So if your sati just focus on one thing, focus more and more, and depending your concentration, it become absorption. And your mind do not know anything, just stay with that thing. And this is very powerful, very, very clear. To that. So this is samadhi. The Buddha used samadhi in the manner of the weight of things. Heavy. If you want to cut things, you need the weight to cut it. But the wisdom that the mindfulness bring is the sharpness. We need together. You practice concentration or samatha to gain the powerful mind. But you need sharpness or wisdom. If you do not know anything, only the powerful mind can do nothing. It's like when you put the wood and you want to cut the string with the wood, it's impossible. You need some sharpness, the wisdom of panya. But only panya without wisdom, only panya without concentration is impossible also. If you have very, very sharp knife but you do not have where to put it, it will not cut. to just touch but do not cut. So we need both. And the mindfulness will bring both of them. If you focus on that thing, you will get concentration. If you see that thing clearly and how to deal with it, this is the vipassana or wisdom. So we need sharp and wet and also fast quality of mind. Vipassana. In fact, anapanasati is also vipassana in the last part, in the last sutra. At the beginning, you need to calm your mind. You stay with your breath. At the beginning, stay with your nose, or you can stay with your rising and falling. This is also the breath. When you're breathing in, it's up. When you're breathing out, it's fall, down. Up and down is also the breathing. It's some relationship with the breath. When you have calm mind, after you follow the in and out, or up and down, this calm mind can see things clearly. Now, vipassana will start. You can see impermanence in the breath, in the emotion, in the feeling, in your mind, in your thoughts, in any, even the sound come and touch your ear. You will see it pass away immediately, clearly. This is the vipassana. So any technique that you use just to see impermanence and let it go, try to practice letting go all the time, so that your mind will be fast to not to attach to anything.
How would one say classify Dhammakaya method?
Dhammakaya practice. I don't know much because I do not practice that way, but first of all, this is good for the people who like visualization. Visualization means you make the mental object, mental image. And sometimes it may give you more concentration. But I'm not sure about when you get the mental image already, what will go? You just stay with that mental image only. If you just stay with that mental image and then you may attach to that thing. And by this way, you will not progress in vipassana. And you want to just get calmness, and you cannot associate with the people. So when you practice in this way, not just do not have wisdom, but sometimes you do not, sometimes you have the misunderstanding also. If you think that to stay with the mental image is good, it's happiness. And some of the Thai people misunderstand that this Dhammakaya is Nibbana. It's the same as the Hindu master who get the absorption, very, very fine absorption, and think this is Nibbana already. But this impermanence is also impermanence. They do not see this impermanence. They think it's happy. It's bright and clear, so it should be Nibbana. By this way, they will not free from all attachment. They free from some material thing, but they attach to this mental thing. If they want to practice vipassana, they must change the technique, because this Dhammakaya technique give them samatha. But I'm not sure about vipassana, because how they can contemplate on the impermanence if they stay with their mental image. But if they teach that this mental image is not real, it's just nibbana, it is just the creation of the mind, that's okay. They may understand more that this is just illusion. The mental image is illusion. It's good by pleasant feeling, but illusion. Let it go. By this way, they will all come. But most of them, as I know, do not teach like this. They teach you to get it, to create the the Dhammakaya crystal ball and then stay with it. This is the goal of your life. It's calm, okay, it's calm and happy, but for some period, not for all activities.
One thing, if the practitioner, while getting all the mental images, when he sees the transition, the changes that takes place in mental image itself is impermanent, and if that particular insight arises in him, you think he would be watching from Vipassana side?
For
Dhammakaya? From, yeah. Just like when we do rising and falling and we get certain feelings, and we see that feelings itself is impermanent, it comes.
Yeah.
It maintains, and then it goes.
Yeah.
And if we see like that, we can see there's changes.
Yeah.
And we think to know that there is an impermanency in the nature of phenomena.
Yeah. In fact, the Dhammakaya, they have visualization, the system ball. But this is about it not last long. If you focus, there will be a new one in that crystal ball. Focus, there is a new one in the crystal ball. But instead of teaching that this crystal ball is changed, is illusion, they said that you need to make a new one until you get the permanent one. This is Nibbana or the highest thing. It's the same as the Chana. You pass the first chana, then get to the second, the third, the fourth, and until this is just form. You develop more in the formless chana, and then you get to the highest formless chana. And you think this is Nibbana already. This is the same. At last, they still have atta or ego, and they use that thing as their ego. In the Hindu concept or in Mahayana, some Mahayana doctrine, they say they teach that we have two selves, the false self and the true self. The false self means the five aggregates, the material things. Everything that we attach is the false self, defilement. But this true self, which is Nibbana. So please get it off false self and have true self. To teach like this is very easy. People can understand. So they get rid of everything so that they can get true self. Okay? So the in the process of get rid of false self is useful. But the true self is paradox also. If you want to process true self, this true self become false self again. So the true self or Nibbana really exists. Because if you want to process it, it's not true self anymore, it's become form self. So the Thai Chan Buddha said that that's not self. Nibbana is not self. Uh-huh. Everything is not self, including Nibbana also. If you take Nibbana, it's yourself. It is no longer Nibbana, it become form self. Okay. Explanation about the characteristic of the one who enlightened. Or the one who achieved some level of Dhamma, but very difficult to measure them because it's the mind. So the Buddha do not use the mind quality or the Dhamma to classify the monk. He used the Vinaya to classify the monk because the Vinaya is really clear. For example, he said that the one who ordained before to sit in front, the one who ordained later, right? So it's really easy to do. But if he said the one who lists Arahant to sit before the one who lists the Sotapanna, very confused. We don't know who is Arahant. And someone may claim that he is Arahant. So I think someone cannot accept. But the one who reached Arahanta may know this is achieved Arahanta or not, because they know this is attachment that they can free already. But we do not reach Arahantship, so we cannot decide that this man or this monk free or not. Some monk, people believe that they achieve Arahanta already, but they still smoke. He still smoke. So the people have discrimination. Some say that, oh, he still smoke, so he cannot achieve Arahanta. Right? Because smoking is very, very, very easy to give up. But some say that, oh, smoking is not nothing concern this his mind. He just take smoking just for the because of the culture or something. So really difficult to make decision. One question also interesting, why we search for Arahanta. People search for Arahanta so that they can offer merit making. And they think that if they offer merit making to the Arahanta, they will get more in return. By this way, they may was deceived because they want to get more. So many people will ask, they will claim themselves as Arahanta. The real Arahanta may not want people to know that he was Arahanta because they want to gain anything. But the one who always say that he is Arahanta should keep in their mind that they may need something. And the Buddha, even though he said that the Arahanta is better than the ordinary monk, but he also suggests that if you want to protect or if you want to take care of the monk, take care of the Sangha instead of take care the personal or the private monk. If you can help the Sangha or the public, this means you want nothing in return. If you want to satisfy one monk who you consider your master or you are the Arahanta, you may have something in return. You may wish something in return. And by this way, people will take care of only high or only famous monk. But the new monk or the novices that have attention to practice Dhamma will not be have no one to take care. But if you take care of the public, the Sangha, everyone who intend to practice Dhamma can get that result. Not only the famous one. So the Buddha said that to offer your help to the Sangha is more fruitful than to offer to anyone, even the Arahanta.
In this connection, what about people who suspect that some monks are false monks?
Yeah.
What happens if they just put on the robes but they don't really keep any of the rules, then how is the Buddhist to, how should they
If you know already, if you know clearly that this monk is not keep the precept, for example, one way is to inform the person who take care of this case, that means the high monk to do this. We may force them to do. But in the with the good riches, not like the newspaper in Thailand like to publish the bad monk's news. When the monk do some things wrong, they will put on the first pages because people will buy the newspaper. But this comes from the mind that do not have good wishes for the Sangha. They want to sell news, right? But if you want the Sangha to consider this, you should inform them, but in the way that do not make people lost their faith, lost their confidence. If the governor or the Sangha governor is good, they must take care of this because this is duty. But if they do not take care of this one, it's certain that the Sangha will weaken and weaker. But as a lay people, in the past we live as a village, as a community. We have the way to control them. Because if they do not behave well, you do not give them the material things. They cannot stay. They must leave. But nowadays it's more complex because the monk have money. The monk have the market. the monk can depend on themselves. In Sri Lanka, for example, the monastery is the private property of the monk. The monk own the land or something like that. So the monk need to go for bindabata, need to go for alms giving. So the people cannot control the monk, because the monk can have all the money. This is the way why the Buddha do not allow the monk to have money, because he want the people to control the monk, to give the material thing. This is to control the monk. If the is that monk is not good, you do not give them the material things. Do not pay respect to them. They cannot stay in this way.
Like in this country, you find that there are a lot of monks, so-called monks, they even advertise in papers that they can do charms, clear black magic, and all that kind of thing. So a lot of uninformed people will always get a wrong impression of what Buddhism is all about. So the Buddha teaches to clear black magic, make charms and things.
One thing you can do is to make people understand correctly what is Buddhism. Buddhism is not super superstitious. Buddhism is not just ceremony. Ceremony is just the what you call the some things that allow Buddhism, but the Buddha Dhamma or the Buddha teaching is different from ceremony. But in ceremony sometimes they can have that they have Buddha Dhamma. But we need to go to the essence of Dhamma or the essence of the teaching. If you inform or if you make the people understand in this way, they can separate the good monk and the bad monk. What is Buddhism? What is not Buddhism? Even though in the monastery, I see the Thai monastery, Wat Chet Wan, have the prophet Buddha. Prophet Buddha is not the Buddha, but it's a Hindu god, right? And it's also certified the people, because the people need some refuge that is easily ask for help. So they come and offer this to the Brahma God. And if people confident in their action, in their karma, they will not go and do such thing. But now people do not confident in themselves. People do not confident in the karma, so they need someone to help them. And you know, the more the society have suffering, the more society have confused, this Hindu God will create more and more, because people have no friends. They have no friends. They feel that they want some help, they go to something. But if they have friends here, if we are all good friends, we help each other. When you suffer, someone help you. You don't need to think about God, right? And if you can depend on yourself, that's the best. Nowadays in the consumer society, in the material progress society, even in Thailand, people are very lonely. So they go to the monastery to perform puja ceremony, and they feel better. This satisfy their need. That's okay, but they do not understand much about Dhamma. So they just get something, but not the essence of the teaching. Some of them go to the fortune teller to tell them the future they will lose or gain in this project, in this business, right? They go to the fortune teller because they feel that they are risk in this project. But if your life is very secure, you don't need to list. You don't need to go to the fortune teller anymore. Or if you want nothing, the fortune teller is meaningless for you, right? But if you want to gain something, the fortune teller is very important, because you want to make sure that you will get it or not. So it depends on your want, on your craving.
Thailand and monks, they seem to conceive the idea of monks, black magic, and sacred words and mantras all
that.
What's the validity of the mantras that sometimes people have been taught to recite? especially sometimes when they go to Thailand, they've been given some mantras and they come back for this protection, for this wealth,
yeah.
For
you know, people will believe in mantra until they know the translation. If they do not know the translation, they think this is very sacred and can have power to protect them. But if you translate the mantra into your language, you know the meaning. It is nothing. It's just the Dhamma. Or sometimes it's just no Dhamma at all. It talk about many gods, but nothing about Dhamma at all. If there's something about Dhamma, if you follow that Dhamma, you may get the good result. So the monk who gives this mantra, he satisfies the people who want something, but it is not scientific. And they, if you help them translate, they will realize that there is nothing. But if they still want to be famous, if they want to be rich, this thing will exist. It's very difficult to get it off if the people still have defilement, because this thing comes to satisfy defilement. But unfortunately, it comes in the name of the Buddhism, comes in the name of the monk or the monastery. People cannot separate. Some monk who knows about fortune teller, about future, he can use this as a method to give the Dhamma to the people. For example, he said that now you are not so lucky, so you must have carefulness. So this man believed him that they must have carefulness in every activities for this period. That's good. And he will free from accident because he has carefulness by this way. But if you know this already, you just be careful in every activity, no problem. You don't need to ask anyone. Because the thing that helps you is mindfulness or carefulness, not anything.
But is there any truth behind the fortune telling? I suppose there must be some truth, since in the Dhammapada there is the case of Ayurvedana, the boy who went to the ascetic for blessing, and the ascetic gave blessings to the parents, may all have long life. They come to the son, he didn't say any long life.
But we do not deny that someone may know the future, but very few. And if you pay too much attention on that thing, you not depend on yourself, your action. It's very easy to slip in the concept that in the idea that ask them to help is better. So by this way, the confidence in yourself will be reduced, and you attach to the master, you attach to the person who can help you. So you cannot dependent, you cannot free. Because of this concept. Ajahn Buddhasa himself, he would not believe in all of these things. He said that it may be true, but he does not pay any attention to these things. And if you practice meditation, control your mind, wise and mindful, and you have no craving, nothing can harm you. No one can make you suffer. No one can have influence on your mind. So this is the highest thing that you can do. So you just do this. And you will gain the best thing. And no one can protect you from these things, can prevent you from these good things. But if you spend too much time on follow someone, magical power, you may not get anything. And the more you pay attention to these things, your mind will be not firm. You will full of doubt, uncertainty. By this way, your mind will not concentrate. Your mind will not have samadhi. And the wisdom very difficult to arise for these people. If you believe in, for example, if you live in rebirth, believe in God, believe in ghost also, and no one believe. Do you angry with them or not? I think many people who believe in these things very much suffer if someone disagree with him. So you don't need to quarrel with them or have some debate. It's useless. It's, if we live in our action, our practice, that's okay. And we don't need to convince any people to believe, to follow us. Sometimes you can convince people to believe the same as you, and this make you to this confirm your belief. So you want people to believe the same as you because you satisfied with that confirmation. But you choose firm or believe what you really see for yourself, not just because all the people believe the same as you.